performance.
Thank you, Lasker. Look, I too would like to add my congratulations, my huge congratulations in a public forum now to you, Minister English. I wish you every success in your job, and I have no doubt that you will be prove yourself to be a very capable minister as you were at TD. I'd like to welcome you to the House for this adjournment debate this evening. Minister, you may be aware of the briefing that was given last week here in the Houses, led by students from the National Learning Network, who are participating in SULIS-funded training. And as a result of reduction in their weekly allowance in the budget 2014, from the 1st of July, they've suffered a €20 reduction per week in their training allowance. The participants at the briefing outlined the negative impact that the reduction has had and what the €20 means to them personally. Many of them, Minister, they all, you know, kind of say living on €188, €20 is a huge amount of money to them. And the participants, I think, brought it all home that where one kind of meant that €20 in her budget at the end of the week was the difference between a healthier diet and an unhealthy diet, therefore improving her lifestyle and reducing the cost to the state and healthcare costs if this was reversed. Another student emotionally spoke about how any reduction in the training allowance would impact negatively on his mental health. He spoke about how much he valued work, the positive effect of SULIS on his life, and his appeal to respect his dignity was indeed very heartfelt. There are 6,300 people in Ireland affected by the reduction of this €20 in the training allowance per week, which amounts to €6.5 million per year. While I do appreciate and I completely understand the government's need to reduce the debt burden, I kind of really find it hard to appreciate the reduction in the training allowance, which affects the well-being of vulnerable Irish people in an unequal way. I believe that the nominal cost, modest cost savings of €6.5 million can be made up elsewhere in the budget. Indeed, I think, you know, if we invest in it, which has been proven in many countries, and what we're trying to do is invest in our young or invest in education. And indeed, I think if we invest our money here, we actually would save money in the long run on healthcare and mental health care costs as well. Minister, I would urge you, and I know that you're barely into the hot seat, but I would ask you, when you do catch your breath, if you would please revisit this reduction in the training allowance. We need to encourage and support the students of SULIS to invest in their professional future. Despite SULIS having a very successful success rate, they have a fantastic success rate, with 90% of their students continuing on to further education or to find a job, which is fantastic for the students who can afford to continue with the training courses. I was kind of concerned last week at some of the students who mentioned the dropout rate, mainly due to financial reasons. I would appeal to you to help and support these students who are in SULIS training programmes, and to help those who struggle to afford to complete a training course by looking at the investment in SULIS-funded training programmes. Investment in SULIS is an investment in our people and economy. It was evident from the stories told by the trainees at the briefing that the training courses are invaluable in getting people back to work, in giving confidence to the students, ensuring greater mental health, in supporting them to get a job, and providing community of support. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Moore. Ministry of Foreigns.
Okay, thanks, Senator Moore. Thanks for your kind words at the start, and I look forward to working with you. Another colleague from the North East, so it's a pleasure to be engaging on my first official duty tonight with yourself as well on this issue. And it's hopefully something we can work on in the future as well. So again, thanks for your kind words, and looking forward to this. A lot of issues we have to cover. I suppose tonight, I'm sorry, I actually missed the briefing last week, just due to the clash of an issue of my own committee. So I would have been interested in maybe meeting a select group from that group of participants to discuss this and talk it through at some stage, maybe. We can have a chat, so I mean, we can certainly do that, to talk to meet them, and certainly I'd be very keen in relation to discussing the dropout rate and those who are affected by it as well. As you know, the payment of an additional training allowance of €31.80 per week for the long-term unemployed was introduced during a period of high employment levels, as an incentive for the long-term unemployed to participate in former FOSS training courses. The payment of this allowance was later extended to those persons in receipt of social welfare disability payments to introduce equality of treatment for all people in training. The payment was reduced from €31.80 per week to €20 per week as part of Budget 2011. In the present economic situation, this incentive is no longer considered appropriate, and as part of Budget 2014, it was decided to cease this payment for all SOLIS participants commencing courses after the 1st of January 2014. This change does not apply to persons who commenced a course prior to January 2014, who will continue to receive the long-term unemployed bonus payment for the duration of their course. It's like a lot of various allowances and additional payments that were generated during the boom years and the Celtic years, where we were making a lot of money. A lot of these allowances were brought in probably rightly at the time, but the tax stream to back them up wasn't put in place. And very often we're using short-term taxes, and now there's a difficulty when there's just a lot less tax there to go around, and that's why you often have these changes as well. However, the travel supports continue to be available to SOLIS participants, including people with a disability. The additional training allowance was never intended to address the cost of participation in training. The nature of the payment as an incentive, rather than as a measure intended to meet the cost of participation, is demonstrated by the fact that it was not available to all people in receipt of payments from the Department of Social Protection, which would have been the case if it were intended to meet meal and travel costs. This reflects the entirely different employment situation that now pertains, as well as the very different budgetary position the government is in, when we're endeavouring to protect the overall level of provision of education and training. It is hoped that participants see the value in education and training as a gateway to employment and will continue to participate in quality, relevant and well-designed programmes. I do accept that they are under immense pressure at all times to survive on that money, whether they attend a course or not. So, you know, I can understand that it certainly would have been a major help to them to have that there. The problem is trying to just balance the books overall. But as I said, I'm happy to meet them to discuss this with them as well. There is no scope to revisit this decision against a very difficult budgetary background where continued savings are required in education and training while needing to protect the overall level of service the sector provides. The further education and training sector is undergoing major structural reform. In reforming our structures, we in further education and training undertook a critical examination of the overall further education and training sector. Following consultation with stakeholders and the development of a strategy for a coordinated FET sector, the second half of last year saw the establishment of 16 education and training boards to replace 33 VECs and the establishment of SOLIS to bring strategic direction to the sector. I am glad to say that at this stage, all former FOSS training provision has been transferred to the education and training boards. The education and training boards will play a key role in ensuring the provision of 21st century high quality further education and training programmes. Any future policy development and legislation in the further education and training sector will be guided by the principles outlined in the five-year strategy document recently published by SOLIS. The overall funding allocation for the Department of Education and Skills is determined as part of the annual budgetary process, and funding allocation is subsequently decided upon in that context, having considered priorities and requirements across the wider education sector. SOLIS will be responsible for allocating funding to the respective education and training boards, the ETBs, in that regard. And it will then be a matter for each ETB to manage its resources annually. Again, Senator, thanks very much for raising this issue with me. As you correctly said, I've just inherited the brief a few hours ago, so it's a really reading into it at the moment, and there's many issues here that we're willing to work on as well. So we'll meet some of these people and try to talk to them as well.
Senator Warren, do you want to supplement?
Thank you. Just to say thank you very much, Minister. For the response, I would really appreciate, and I'll certainly take you up on that offer to meet with some of the people from the NLN who are directly involved, and to get an idea of it. I do appreciate that you're only in the job a few hours, but as spokesperson for education on this side of the house, I want to make sure that we we have plenty to talk about into the future. So I thank for that.
No, listen, I can't have you with that question.
That's right.
Thank you, Senator Moore.
Thanks very much.
Thanks, Minister.